Greetings, humans, living and dying in the Anthropocene. This is Jamming Their Transmission, where rebels, freaks, critics, dissidents, iconoclasts, and oddballs live. I'm your fellow traveler, John Madero. In the Deep Zoo, her collection of essays published by Coffee House Press, Rikki Ducornet writes, quote, "A world worth wanting cherishes the risks of wildness, and this includes not only the lavish elephants and meteoric crabs, but the stars we can no longer see, the whales hemorrhaging on our beaches, the serene mollusks and coral reaches, Gilgamesh as filmed by the Brothers Key, the eroticized Martians imagined by Clarice Lispector, the Amazon's poison frogs, the Sahara's thick-coming locusts, the vociferous parrots, William Gass's omen setter, the worms in their legions and the yellow boas, Rosamund Purcell's and Van Leeuwenhoek's third eyes, and Borges's Aleph, the oracle at Delphi, and Gaudí's dream of an unbounded architecture, the necessary nightmares of David Lynch, Borges's incandescent blindness, Prince Genji's amorous encounters, the collages of Max Ernst, his Lop-Lop, and above all, the salutary tradition of a tusked and savage, and need I say it, subversive storytelling in which the world is reinvented, reinvigorated, and restored to us in all its sprawling splendor over and over again." Rikki Ducornet is a transdisciplinary artist whose work is animated by an interest in nature, eros, abusive authority, subversion, and the transcendent capacities of the creative imagination. She is the author of 9 novels, collections of essays, short fiction, and poetry. Of her work, William Gass wrote, quote, "Rikki Ducornet's books search for a way to heal the wound in our psyche, our shame and suppression of our nature, which has led not only to denial of this world on behalf of another one, but has repeatedly allowed authority and its agents to blind us to beauty, to make our passions poisonous, and to corral and confine the imagination." Unquote. Here is Rikki Ducornet reading from her short fiction collection, The One Marvelous Thing.
Okay, this is called Qigong. Once ejected from her module, Qigong set forth to find complex systems. Our defeated expectation is manifest in her report. 1. Primates wear their pearls between their lips, whereas oysters conceal theirs beneath their tongues. Birds lay their pearls in their beards. The female of the hairless ape wears her pearl but a finger's length from her anus. 2. Whereas birds sit on their beards, some apes wear theirs on their heads or between their legs. Mussels use their beards to grasp the underside of submarines. 3. Although they produce shit, all terrestrial creatures, bearded or bald, are ephemeral. 4. On Earth, species hierarchies are not readily discernible. Absurdity, the inevitable outcome of scatological systems, rules to lethal effect. Such drear redundancies darken the entire galaxy. 5. Earth is cacophonous, and bile has sullied its waters. Battles are fought in God's name over beards and the length of the earlobe. God, Earth's lesser Archon, whose cipher is bloody flux, and whom we, in our wisdom, have repudiated.
That's wonderful.
This is the scouring. So what I'm doing right now is writing a sci-fi, which entails a robot and his person on a road trip. So this is the first time I wrote about robots, this story called The Scouring. How grateful I am for the scouring. The physical world, once so overwhelming, is now reduced to level plains, and we may press onward, fearless of obstruction. I recall with a certain residual horror the fetid smell so common in my youth, the stench of rotting vegetable matter, of blossoms wantoning in the untamed season called spring, the aggravation of birdsong, the heady impositions of summer, when the bird baths were green with the scum of stagnant water. that fall, its rank odors of dead leaves, the terrible bodies of things that scuttled about in those leaves, the persistence of slugs. One might have, within an hour, been harried by a butterfly, or worse, a moth, a wasp, a bee, or a spider, stewing in its own malevolence right under one's very bed. I almost forgot winter, that season of damp basements. The new generation has no inkling of these things. They could not care less. I do not wish to burden them with my stories of the past and its baroque intrusions. It would be criminal to trouble their placid velocities, the ordered economy of their meditations, with my relic tales of obstacles overcome. They know nothing of the scouring, the horrors of the transition, the blind optimism of the reconstruction. This is how it should be. The new generation is serene, propelled like beams of light, yet not disembodied, although this will surely come. Together we sweep across the globe in imitation of the cosmical machine. The sound of wind, the wind of our own making, is the only sound we hear. No footfalls, no gnashing of teeth, no conversation. We are no longer the playthings of the weather, gossip, temper, or appetite. For a time, it is true, I missed the smells of cooking, and in the secret sanctum of my kitchen, now off limits, I did not neutralize the air, but instead heightened the experience, now impossible to describe, by sealing the windows and the door. I'd make a stew of lamb, say, or bake a gingerbread, not to eat them, mind you, for already we had overcome the vicious cycle of corporeal servitude. But to inhale those fragrances, it all seems so very long ago now. I would luxuriate, please, not a word of this to anyone, in the scrubbing of the pots and pans. In the old days, I was considered soft, a man who liked to cook, a stupid activity. Cooking like sex stimulates all the senses to an extraordinary degree. These days, I barely recall the sound of butter sizzling in the pan, but I know it was a thing I much appreciated as a child. And the apples glazed with caramel that shattered against the teeth. It bewilders the new generation to hear of such things. Should we describe the teeth and their function, they are appalled. Not to mention the art of relieving oneself on the can, a sorrowful redundancy, or so they suppose. Such conversations are brief and they happen so rarely. Once there was an anomalous obstruction in the path, and we were brought to a precipitous halt unexpectedly. I collided into the person in front of me, a tremendous shock, you can well imagine, to the system. We were fenced in on each side by the bright titanium tussocks so favored by the highway authorities. I could see she was distressed by the number of nicks and pox on surfaces she had thought impervious to time and the vicissitudes of space. It was eerie not to feel the wind of forward motion. For some reason, I was impelled to speak, an old habit that reveals the extent of my dotage. I only wished to, as we used to say, crack a joke when I suggested we get a coffee and relax while waiting for the system to be repaired. This offended her. The new generation is mysteriously ashamed not to have a mouth, a tongue, or teeth. I should have stopped there, but something, and I admit this was perverse, criminally so, prodded me on. There were once so many palpable pleasures, I conveyed to her with our ever more restricted vocabulary. I wish, I dearly wish you had a pair of lips so that I could kiss you. She was a bright cobalt blue, but when she blushed, a thing beyond my wildest expectations, she turned violet, a color she had surely never seen. It is a pity and a shame, I continued, moved beyond belief, that you are so fiercely serrated. In another time and place, I might have cooked you dinner, and after, we might have eagerly embraced. This was madness on my part. I knew such talk would cause my jaws to seize up within minutes and quite possibly cause her to fatally percolate. Already something very like steam was spilling from her post-acoustical ducts. We were bombarded by bright clusters of echoing forms, a spillage precipitated by the unexpected obstruction and the ensuing exquisite collision. With something of the old delight, I noted that the concave mirrors of her eyes reflected both the tussocks and the sky above us. I wish, I confided, we could taste each other. She darkened further and condensed. To my surprise, I could now behold her many aspects simultaneously. My own eyes, so unaccustomed to exercise, selected favorite objects and guessed the lovely disarray quickening beneath her dusky shell. Between the dazzling planets of her breasts, her heart twinkled. Your beauty, I conveyed to her, is a force and an atmosphere. At that precise instant, the obstacle dissolved. Had I been able to use my nose, this dissolution would have been accompanied by the smell of burnt toast. Stillness invites reflection and its familiar subversion. Now that we were moving, the world was shut away. Already the emblematic encounter, I am, I admit, what was once called romantic, and the memory of that encounter eluded me. Imagine rocks and raked sand, but tinned, as in the past, sardines were tinned in oil, and you will have some idea as to the nature of my thinking once we were underway again.
This is Jamming Their Transmission. I'm John Madera. You have been listening to Rikki Ducornet reading from The One Marvelous Thing. Hearing phrases like corporeal servitude, scatological systems, and playthings of weather in the story you just read, I can't help but think that the fiction's old generation resembles the actual one, the current one we have the nerve to call real life.
There we are, indeed. I've been reading so much about AI and really concerned, you know, deeply concerned and puzzled by our absolute gnostical discomfort within our own bodies and terror of the material body. And I think this scrambling of truth is perhaps a kind of extension of that, you know, that we're turning away from the real, beginning with our own bodies. I mean, this fascination with sex robots, So deeply distressing and peculiar. It's really happening. Apparently, they're opening one in a sex bot brothel in Vancouver and Seattle. So it's getting very close to home. So what does that say about our relationship with the real? Why are we so distrustful of it? You know, what is that? What is this strange business of moving towards the disembodied, you know? I found that's what I'm writing about in unexpected ways.
Your narrator says they're searching to find complex systems. And I think this is true of you. That is, you're constantly seeking complexity, systemic complexity, seeking complex systems, and also dismantling them when and where necessary. Where does this tendency come from, this rigorous attention to complexities of systems?
Writing, as you know, is so mysterious. But for me, I think from the beginning, it was so much about attempting to understand the world. And so maybe on the one hand, trying to articulate the complexities around me, also trying to find a language to deal with the complexities and the contradictions with our own thinking, And trying to find a way towards, you know, a kind of clarity of mind, actually. I think my writing is much less baroque now. So much a part of it for me early on was simply the delight in language, and that language would call forth language, that it feels like such a living thing, often in one's hands. And now I find myself paring back. So the more recent novels, Brightfellow and Netsuke, are trimmed way back. They're both very short novels, and this novel that I'm writing now is going to be tiny, a novella probably, part of that trimming back, wanting to engage a lot of complex ideas, but in as clear, sort of down-to-the-bone way as I can.
Another phrase you use in one of these fictions is palpable pleasures, and there are many such pleasures in these fictions and in your writing as a whole. Why this attentiveness to language, to the materiality of language?
I'm interested in the power of language to evoke worlds, and then in the evoking of the worlds to, in fact, vanish. At some point, the delight in the language falls away. I mean, I think that's really important because I love to play with language. I'm enchanted by language, and it is a sensuous enchantment, I think. I mean, I love what happens when words collide. I love the way the very sounds of world words will change the meaning of the words you're using or heighten them. Mm. And I like the idea of the words making for a kind of magic that sparks the text. But I'm also fascinated by what happens when the language does fall away and we're engaged in a profoundly visual and sensuous experience. And then it becomes a kind of cinema. And I'm very aware of that right now with the book I'm writing, because I see it, actually I see it as an animation, animated cartoon even.
Hmm.
But there's a moment when Bugs Bunny actually appears as a little key to that. So I'm playing with that, trying to find a vocabulary that, and I think I always am actually interested in that, that is often very, very cinematic or evokes a kind of cinematic experience. So I think must be true of all fiction writers, you know, poets. I think that's as true of writing, that as engaging and exciting as the language is, that it will fall away and give us a direct experience that's palpable, that's visible. All the senses are awakened.
Bugs Bunny, at least in his earliest incarnations, was a kind of trickster figure.
Right.
In the cartoons.
Yeah. Yeah. He is a subversive figure. He just sort of suddenly surfaces on a screen within a spaceship as a kind of avatar pointing the way. So definitely a trickster avatar. because the trip, of course, as all these trips are, you know, all these road trips in space full of pitfalls and crazy unexpected dangers. This is one problem to face after another.
Speaking of...
you're right. I mean, trickster. There is definitely what he is.
Speaking of unexpected pitfalls, one possible pitfall a writer faces is writing from the perspective of the so-called other. These pieces, though, find you deftly writing from the perspective of the other. In one case, a man's perspective, right?
Well, definitely the robot. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the robot's definitely a man. And I think first when I read the Qigong, really could be anything at all, because it's another creature entirely, so from another galaxy, probably. But I do move around a lot, so this current book is definitely in two main voices, so others appear, but the robot is male, such as he can be, and the astronaut is an astronautist, so very much female. But they're also both gay, and that's been interesting to examine, too, because I'm very interested in mutability, and I'm very interested in what's becoming so evident now across our beleaguered universe is that love really has no boundaries, and that the body has as much capacity to be delighted and to offer tenderness and to imagine as the mind, and we've been terribly hampered by these preposterous ideas that again are rooted in the fear of the body and the fear of pleasure and fear of receiving and giving affection. And the universe is mutable and things are in constant transformation, so the idea that anything is fixed, including our sexuality, is absurd. And one of the things that's happening, you know, this time which is so fraught and has everyone embracing trees and sobbing, you know, so many people I know, is also dealing with these marvelous revelations that we are creatures capable of infinite loving, and that cut off from our own bodies are also cut off from the body of the world, and that this is a terrible thing. I mean, really, part of it too is not just sexual, but also all that is lost when we're no longer listening to the conversations of the, for example, the insects and the birds around us, or the plants around us, that all this is vanishing, and many places has already vanished. And what does that say about our own impoverishment? Obviously, infinite experiences that are being reduced. And that's what fascism does, you know, it just cuts everything down, whittles everything down, ultimately to shit, really, is where it goes. And then it shrieks, see, I told you all along, that's all there is, you know, having burned everything around.
What is the artist's role within these fear-based, fear-causing times, these impoverished times, these whittled-down times? What can
That's tremendously important question. Well, I think more than ever, I mean, the creative imagination is absolutely essential to our humanity. It's absolutely essential to our survival as a species.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Depends upon the other. It depends upon the creatures. It depends upon a healthy environment, healthy ecologies. Mm-hmm. You know, it depends on life. Creative imagination is what makes the world worth living, worth wanting. And it's also absolutely essential to the evolutionary process. I mean, we're discovering more that we learn about the creatures around us, the systems around us, the planets around us. We realize that what we have been calling human intelligence is terrestrial intelligence, and that things do not evolve. They cannot survive without intelligence and also without memory. Now, all of this is I think, a sacred space. I mean, nothing to do with churches, but a profoundly sacred space, and we must hold it. You know, it's up to us to hold it. And I think it's interesting because in some ways what's happening now is, as many of us are considering, the possibility that we could be the final creatures creating art. You know, heaven forbid, but it's not impossible.
Yeah.
So what does that mean? So that means then that the act itself, and that has always been true, the creative act is what is sacred, what matters, what is essential to our well-being. And I think to those around us as well. You know, culture is a thing that we share. That's why it's so important. So to be back to the initial, the central, iconic, and deep experience of creating means that we're in for the adventure. You know, we're in for the deep experience and the deep learning it offers. And we're not thinking about publishers. We're not thinking about even readers. We become the first reader, the first to witness the work. I think that really matters, because then the work is, it has this kind of fire and purity too. And the magic there is that when one inhabits that place, the work holds that place, then when you do share it, you're offering something that's truly worthy of being shared, and hopefully has a real beauty and a real truth to it. And those words matter. I mean, these words, truth and beauty, reality, fact,
yes.
Honesty, and all of this, these words have meaning. They matter. Many of us are dying for them. I think there's also what's happening now with this sort of war on the child. You know, if you fear the body and fear sexuality and the genitals are sullied, you know, and despised, then of course you hate the child. So then we're at the end of the road. I mean, when we start incarcerating children and put them in cages, when we have prisons devoted to children, as in Syria, you know, Venezuela, then we're at the end of the road.
Mm-hmm.
So the creative path is the only way out. It's always been, I think. It matters more than ever. It matters more than ever. I mean, we have to hold on to our humanity, and this is the most human thing. And what's wondrous about it, too, is that I'm going on and on. I realize I'm upset.
please go on. Please go.
It's joy, you know, it's the creative imagination is what we share with all things around us. Now, I've noticed these fabulous connections, which have been there for peoples who live within the wild, who have lived within the wild. Nothing that so much of the West has never been able to comprehend, you know, it's seen as demonic somehow. All of that is where we belong in our ecology. I don't know if that just made much sense. I mean, what I guess I'm trying to say is that the creative imagination is born of the healthy natural ecologies in which we flourish, and receives from it and gives back to it. And that's what, again, that's what makes it so exquisitely special and wondrous, and it's astounding, being conscious, you know, being aware.
Who are some artists from that wellspring who have inspired you?
Oh, it's interesting. I just found myself returning to Octavio and Sunstone.
Mm-hmm.
And been rereading Cortázar, I've been rereading Roberto Calasso's fabulous Ka, which is a book I find myself turning to again and again. Ka, K-A, meaning the name of the power, the God power, the sacred power beyond everything, and it means who? Anyway, his Ka is marvelous compendium of the earliest stories, Hinduism leading up to Buddhism. Anybody hasn't read it yet, that's one book to have. It's glorious. He's a brilliant storyteller, an amazing scope and knowledge of Indian philosophy and so much else, but incredible handle on the power of, and beauty of these stories. so I've been retreating. He wrote Cadmus and Harmony, which is perhaps his most famous book, which is also a kind of tree of life of the myths of Greece. So from the very beginning on, and you just watch the myths growing and becoming richer and stranger.
Do you find yourself rereading more these days? Or is that a normal practice for you?
It's a normal practice, but I'm also reading for this book. I just finished one of the most fascinating books I've read in a while called Gods and Robots by Adrienne Mayer. I'm not quite sure how it's pronounced. She wrote a book called The Amazons, which I haven't read yet. But she's writing about the extraordinary fact. I mean, she's done all this research that the Greeks, maybe 300-400 BC, were already developing these immense and powerful and expressive and very complex automatons. So they didn't have AI, but they were impressive and they could do a lot of things, and they were perceived as the gods or works of the gods. And that a lot of money was put into these things. And so, you know, the technicians who were creating these things had enormous support. And so she's separated out the myths and the myths of the gods and the actual machines that were there. And it's a very impressive argument and very convincing. And apparently there were other places, China as well. And again, the emperors were putting an enormous amount of money into this research. And also the Arab world, same thing, had these magnificent complex automatons, spitting fire, talking, walking. And she talks about Pygmalion, who created a gorgeous ivory lover for himself, and he fell madly in love with this ivory doll. And I read that chapter at the point when the news was out about these bordellos with sex bots nearby. And one of the things that fascinated me about the book is that as soon as you have not just animated statues but beautiful statues, people historically have fallen in love with them. And apparently that was one of the moral dilemmas that the Greeks already were attempting to deal with.
Hence Plato's open hostility to the arts, to artists and poets, even calling for banishing them from the polis.
Oh, well, that's another thing. And banishing astronomers who had figured out that we were zipping around the sun and not the other way around. Yeah. But that, too, is so interesting. And, you know, this sort of hatred of science that's getting in the way right now so dramatically, fear of science, scientific inquiry. So how does that fit in with our culture's disdain for the artist? And I think it's just simply a fear of the creative imagination, which is that place of acute subversion always. And it can't be pinned down. It can't be reduced unless you reduce the person.
You are an exemplar of such acute subversion and of creative rebellion and nurturing. In the face of being devoured by the corporate death machine, what keeps you going?
Oh, well, it's the key to life, you know. I mean, it again, more than ever, you know, which is why I think, you know, often in hiding with risk to life in countries of profound repression, artists continue to create their work. It continues to thrive. It's passed, you know, poems are passed hand to hand or remembered, and people find ways of sharing the beauty and marvelousness that the creative imagination proposes, offers. And again, because the creative imagination is as much the place for art as science, again, more than ever, we need to be thinking creatively. I mean, more than ever, I think more than ever, we need to be as thoughtful, attentive as we can possibly be. More than ever, we need to find ways to one another, you know, and be as compassionate and receptive as possible. More than ever, act upon the things that really matter. And we are. I mean, I'm thrilled by what's happened to the house. And I'm also thrilled by the fact that, you know, things are shifting in terms of dire need to act to save our ecological systems. That's beginning to see some movement. It may be too late, but we have to keep acting as though it is not, because we really don't know.
Right.
There may be a way to at least hold things in place and then begin to turn them around.
Hmm.
I'm excited by, I read a lot, and I'm very interested in what NASA is doing. I'm very interested in the space program. I feel one of the tragedies is that we could easily, if we had been less vicious bunch of primates had not only our gorgeous planet safe, but been already on our way to others, you know. I think we're inevitably going to want to do that. We're a curious tribe and have always gone off to explore.
We might have to.
We might have to. That's what's happening. It's happening very quickly. I mean, we're going to be seeing very likely the first arrival on Mars within, you know, the decade.
Would you read some more for us?
Sure. With pleasure.
Great.
Okay. So I'm still back in this book called The One Marvelous Thing. Well, this is nutty. So this is just sort of a fantastical thing. It's not really about space or the future. Its characters are all unnamed species of mollusks and stuff like that. So it's called The Dick Mare. It all boils down to this. Does she present to the Dick Mare or not? She fears a lot of them, those perpetually inflated Dick Mares, their uncanny magnetism matched only by their startling lack of symmetry. Yet she has been summoned, a thing as unprecedented as it is provoking. And she is awakened with a curious rash. It circles her body like a cummerbund, a rash as florid as those coral gardens so appreciated by lovers at bijouterie, a rash having surged directly, or so she supposes, from her husband's anomalous, or so she hopes, behavior. Once she had thought her husband admirable his thorny cone, his sweet horny operculum, his prowess as a swimmer, the beauty of his sudden ejections, the ease with which he righted himself when overturned. Not one to retreat into his shell in those days, his high spirits percolated throughout the yellow mud they optimistically called home. Adolescence intellectually annihilated by lust and hopeful mysticism would engage her husband for hours on end with thorny topics, such as why Noah built the ark without once questioning the high clam's outburst of temper. And if the high clam loves the fishes and the shelled fishes best, after all, they did not suffer during the 40 days and nights of rain, but instead benefited. Why were they snatched in numbers from their naps and served up topside, boiled in beer, and dressed with hot butter? And her husband instructed the small fry with cautionary tale, featuring the terrible kraken, who swims on the surface of the waves like a gigantic swan, downing mischievous little mollusks at will, the fear of the lie quieting both their wanderlust and their exuberance. And some were so shellacked with fear, they slammed shut, never to be heard from again. The old-timers, too, came to her husband for advice, sleepless in expectation of those fearsome migrations they were impelled to entertain periodically for reasons beyond everyone's grasp. It seemed that everybody was in need of advice all the time, and that her husband's ministry never ceased. At first she had been proud of his popularity, or rather had done her best not to hate the constant tide of traffic and babardage. She would shut her eyes and cling to anything, to debris, a rotting hull, a stump of pier, a branch of folifera, and she would dream unfructuous dreams of the sacred arms of rivers that are said to feed the sea, uncertain waters flowing from an unknowable source because topside, a source she wished to find. Her husband's popularity came to a sudden halt right after a doleful interlude with a Cuckfield quintuplet whom he had surprised in their daily rotation over by Sandy Bottom. Now no one, not even the squamosas who wear their digestive tubes in their arms, will give either of them the time of day. Once so admired, her husband has taken his problems to a dick mare, and there is a scary rhyme the small fry trill about him. When the moon is out and the bivalves hop and cannot stop, and a shadow steals above, tell me, what is it? What is it, my love? A dick mare who orders up nacreous pills from the oyster shop, pills that resemble tube hinges, and once swallowed, produce an egg capable of sprouting fins and swimming. These days, her husband's conversation is as rare as a clam's liver. He has lost the instinct for cordiality, and his capacity for mobility is sorely compromised. He has developed two pairs of vocal palpi, and even if he had wanted to, she would not want him to kiss her. When in motion, he takes no great strides, but instead stretches out his foot so slowly that she, who stands at the ready with a glass of water, these days his thirst is prodigious, fears the tedium will kill her. But then, having to set the right foot down, he withdraws the left, so suddenly that crying out, she drops the tumbler, wetting her apron. When he is mercifully out of the door, another unexpectedly vigorous push with his left foot sends him headlong into his vehicle. Is it a squid or a calamar? When her husband returns, he wishes to engage her. Occupying the recliner, he kneels on his knuckles, inching forward with one hand on each end of the apparatus. This, she fears, may lead to further disability. She can tell he has taken the other pills, the one the size of a grain of linseed, which, like those the size of a split pea, and unlike those the size of a small haricot bean, are, at the instant of ingestion, spat out upon the floor. She stands at the ready, her small broom resting at her side. The fine salmon pink of her husband's cheeks has darkened, and his skin exudes a peculiarly pungent odor reminiscent of dead eels. Provoked by the prescribed medicaments, within the hour she knows he will turn upon himself like a wheel in motion. Her husband displays his lameral and viscid portions. He wishes to excite her curiosity as, he tells her, she has excited the Dickmares, who, having asked to see her photograph and at once been satisfied, extends an invitation to his grotto. The Dickmare suggests that she is distinguished from the schools of others of her kind by a brilliancy of eye that, added to her moist plumpness, renders her the most appealing an elephant who could aspire to. She is a treasure, the single form reflected in a plurality of lesser forms, or rather, she is that plurality reflected in a singular form. Unclear as to what he has said, still, she cannot help but be moved, as creatures such as she, so fraught with disappointments, swarm within his reach, easy prey for lesser contenders, those who do not have access, as the Dickmares do, to the tops of rocks, nor have they access to the medicines. And it is true, she is lovely, vitreous, and permeable, her bottom globulous. Aroused, she is luminous in the dark, so round, so smooth, so perfectly ablaze in her posterior part. No one, she muses, has noticed these things for a very long time. And so after all these months watching her husband pull himself across the floor in fractions, a transaction that is always accompanied by frequent vomitings and a prodigious thirst, she weighs her chances, risky business. Or is it a dick? After all, the Dickmares are known to unspool and push their pistons forward with such alacrity, a subconical cavity will be stunned into service before it has a chance to ignite. And she fears that rather than excite his compassion, the curious rash now tumbling to her knees like a Samoan's grass skirt will excite his scorn and, what's more, his wrath. Yet it is also true that she has just that morning shed her shell, a thing both temporary and wildly appealing. If she is at her most vulnerable, she is also at her most charming. The rash, she hopes, may well be a function of this transformation, her heightened state. Her beauty, she can see this now, has never been more poignant. It boils down to this. Might the Dickmare provide a pill less bitter than the one she has sucked ever since the Cuckfield Fry gave voice to their many peculiar complaints? Might the Dickmare assuage her loneliness and her humiliation? Is she afflicted enough to dare seek out a questionable success with an upper mutter known to be sensuous, furious, and cruel? And she's so fragile, so amply furnished with tender sockets and delicate rosettes, rotundular and soft. Yes, above all, she is soft and so easily impressed. It is said at death, and once the flesh has dissolved into the limitless bodies of things so small they cannot be perceived by the naked eye, the soul is swept away by a current called forgetfulness, and carried to an edifice of foam, so impalpable no one has ever seen it. She wants to be the one to see it and to inform the others as to its nature.
Wow, that was wonderful.
You know, I just realized your wonderful book, there is a itching skin is an issue in your book.
Mm-hmm.
And here I've got this going on with the Dick Mayer's next victim. So what is it about rashes? Why is that at the heart of your book, or is it too soon to talk about it?
Oh, I'm happy to talk to you about it. The narrator suffers from what may or may not be a psychosomatic illness, the early warning sign of which is an itch he can't scratch, so it might be a neurological itch. And it's meant to be a play on a metaphorical itch he can't scratch, an unsatisfied desire which he can't or won't allow himself to satisfy or even to understand. So it might be a play on unknowability and woeful, willful ignorance of the body of desire, his body, his desire, wants, needs. And he seeks out various cures which lead to further doubts, fears, and failures, and questions for something that might ultimately be unanswerable, unknowable.
Yeah, that's terrific.
Thanks, Rikki. But getting back to the story you just read, there's a wonderful line about the soul being swept away by a current called forgetfulness. It's a line that made me think once again about the contemporary moment where it feels like we've been swept away by a tsunami wave of forgetfulness.
Yeah, exactly. Everything is being swept away. I mean, everything that really speaks to us is being swept away and speaks to our children. I mean, this is, you know, again, what is happening to the world's children.
So
It's heartbreaking. I mean, how... And we belong in a functioning ecological system, and children so profoundly respond to the natural world, and it's so essential to their developing imaginations and way of being healthy within their minds and bodies. And the natural world, too, is the place of all our great stories.
Mm.
Now, all the fairy tales are going to be completely incomprehensible. I mean, all the amazing evocations of deep forest and the mysteries and beauties and terrors there and the speaking creatures. And they do, you know, and they did. I mean, that is also one of the mysteries only now we're beginning to really comprehend, that, my God, trees actually do not only speak to one another chemically, but percussively. That's wild. Or that birds have family names. That's wild. Dolphins each have a particular individual name. Now, all of this is marvelous and such a wealth there to investigate and then to engage with. And meanwhile, it's just slipping through our hands. Just at the very moment when we begin to recognize the incredible amount of fabulous stuff that's on the verge of being available and shared, and we're losing it.
This story has a kind of permeability between the quote-unquote natural world and the quote-unquote supernatural. And this is a wonderful tendency of your writing as a whole, which offers non-hierarchical spaces where you go in and out of the so-called real and the so-called unreal or irreal.
Well, I grew up on fairy books and also kind of uncannily tumbled into surrealism at a very young age.
Mm.
I mean, for one thing, it was the kind of shiny skin of surrealism was very visible because of Salvador Dalí being such a big figure everywhere, and particularly in the United States. And I think he'd been banished from the surrealist group because his politics were so lousy already. But what was known as surrealism, you know, was initially, I think, Dalí. And my mother was fascinated by Dalí and had this actually fabulous book called 100 Secrets of Magic Craftsmanship in the house. And as a little kid, I think it was 6 or 7, I used to look at that book. And then when I was 8, discovered my first visit to I grew up in the Bard College campus, and there was a wonderful library. And my first visit to the library discovered this beautiful book that was illustrated by Max Ernst with poetry by Paul Éluard. And that totally turned my life around, I think. I mean, I think my imagination was profoundly charged by the experience of discovering that book unexpectedly. And I felt a kind of kinship with it. And one of the things about, I think, surrealism so interesting as well is the way, the importance of the natural world and the way Ernst, his collages constantly refer to his own avatar, which he called the Lop-Lop, which is a kind of bird man or sort of a kind of powerful, magical being that haunts much of his work. The book was called Misfortunes of the Immortals. It was full of early references to the Lop-Lop, if they kind of haunt that book. But that, you know, that meant that my own sort of progress as an artist was very early on informed with the marvelous, that particular brand of the marvelous, and over time informed the work. There's an important encyclopedia coming out in the spring called International Encyclopedia of Surrealism in three volumes, which is going to be very expensive. It's going to land up, I think, in libraries mostly, but very beautiful. I think that's going to have a big impact also on the arts community, because there's nothing like it has ever really been done.
I love how you...
Very active. You keep talking. I'm sorry. Go on.
No, I'm sorry.
What you love.
Well, I love the story you told about yourself as a little girl growing up on the Bard campus and using the library there, which I'm sure was amazing, especially as a child of this kind of huge space. You were connecting the library and your experiences there with the haunting, the unexpectedness, the mystery, the magic, the marvelous.
Yeah. I mean, what was so wild, too, about that library was you had to cross this green glass bridge to get to the second story stacks. You go up this staircase, you'd get on this little glass bridge, which was beautiful and absolutely terrifying because you'd be walking on glass. And if you looked, so when you were on the glass bridge looking down, and because the glass was green, that meant the whole first floor of the library looked like it was underwater. And I would have these dreams about aquariums after that. Anyway, I walk across the bridge, and right there on the left is this book with a spine with the same blue as a fabulous robin's egg that I had 2 years earlier, which had been smashed in the hands of a friend of my mother's. And it was a very emblematic moment and powerful one, and that color blue really spoke to me. So there was this spine that was the first thing I grabbed. I mean, my first experience of a library was a green glass bridge and this blue spine of a perfectly astounding book. And yeah, and so libraries ever after have had this kind of immense impact on my imagination.
I love, love, love libraries. And so I'm alarmed by how much space machines are taking in libraries, how the stacks are being slowly replaced by computers and whatnot.
It's an enormous loss. You know, when I began, well, one thing I've always loved about the old-timey libraries is that you would walk in and make these discoveries all the time just because there was a spine that had a particular je ne sais quoi about it across the room, or a title. Uh-huh. Or you just find yourself in a section unexpectedly because you were looking for something else and having trouble finding it. Mm-hmm. And so many of my early novels are so dependent on objective hazards, where I would just walk into the library, you know, expecting, longing for an encounter, almost, you know, like an amorous encounter. You know, what what will I find? And finding amazing things that I had no notion even existed. And then I when I was in teaching University of Denver, that library, as so many libraries, was getting rid of things all the time. I learned that if a book had not been taken out for a certain number of years, they would just trash it. And a bunch of us just started taking out these marvelous old books just to keep them there, keep them in circulation, or parent circulation. Oh, yeah, that's an immense loss. I mean, that was one of the things also that entranced me and continues to about certain aspects of surrealism is that the dependence on these miraculous encounters, you know, which are everywhere when you have such things as libraries and forests, wild places of all kinds, and joyous city streets where you don't risk being shot in the back by a cop, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I love what your act of keeping books in, as you say, circulation suggests, evokes, books being a kind of lifeblood.
Yeah. You found that, and that's wonderful. That's lovely.
And speaking of lovely things, in the story you just read, there's a tremendous attentiveness to details. This is true of all of your work. And especially tiny things, the things that often go unnoticed. You talk about the linseed grains, the split peas, the haricot beans. It's almost Bachelardian.
I love Gaston Bachelard. You probably know that. The poetics of space and earth and discoveries of repose and water and dreams have been absolutely essential friends. I mean, all my first novel, God, this one is the 10th that I'm working on now. It's impossible, but all the time, you know, Bachelard has been the companion. He's always been there, sometimes full-time, and other times I just simply find myself just simply wanting to go for the companionship and the inspiration.
Mm.
So I think those are really essential books.
This is Jamming Their Transmission. I'm John Madera. I'm speaking with Rikki Ducornet, who will now read from The Deep Zoo.
So The Deep Zoo is, as you know, a collection of essays on the creative imagination. And
I'm lucky to have a signed copy, inscribed copy from the author herself.
So there's an essay in there called Books of Natural and Unnatural Nature.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'll read the last moment of that, which is called Breath. Because that does fit in so well with what we've been talking about.
Mm.
So there is a small mollusk, the size of a baby's fingernail. Over time, its foot has transformed to wings, with which it navigates the oceans. A pteropod, it is fondly called a sea butterfly. Essential to the food chain, it feeds the fish that penguins and polar bears depend upon. The sea butterfly is protected by its shell, but because of the precipitous acidification of the oceans, this shell is compromised. Within 40 years, the sea butterfly will have vanished. A perfect thing, always identical to itself, primordial, and until now imperishable, I think the sea butterfly is like the sacred vowels of Islamic mysticism, alluded to at the beginning of this essay, the I, the A, and the U, said to spell the world. Their essential virtues are encapsulated by a consonant that protects the vowel from the eyes of the profane, just as it signals its presence to the initiated. In this way, the I becomes min, the A, wa, and the U, nun. These extensions secure the vowel's power. Unlike any other science, Islam's science of letters is a meta-science said to precede words and ideas, even the names of things. It is the science of the sacred breath made manifest, the breath that animates a world and assures its survival. Imagine a book of nature that acknowledges, assures, and embraces the entire ecology of the planet as it respires. A world book that, like the song lines of the whales and the Australian Aborigines, both reveals and precipitates meanings in the singing. A book of nature that, as do the songs of the F.A. pygmies of the Aturi rainforest, fuses the voices of insects, animals, and birds, even the sounds of thunder, lightning, and rain, making for an acoustic ecology. Imagine the book, as Borges describes it, that you and I are writing, embracing a world in which everything is given voice, the creatures and the plants, the waters, within their cells, the alphabets coiled tightly within those waters, ready to unspool and quicken. A book in which everything is sparking, everything breathes. Because our appreciation of plenitude, of the extraordinary, the unanticipated, the unknown, the ineffable, is essential to our natures. It is embodied. It makes us wise. Because Eros is sparked by sympathies, not just between ideas, objective hazards, and leaps of mind, but encounters with mystery, the mystery of otherness, and also, and evolution assures this, of likenesses. I'm thinking of those instances over which we have no control that surpass our wildest imaginings. Here, aesthetic intuition lies in ambush, fertile and dynamic, invigorated by delight. Like the sea, the moment, and it is forever, is upon us. The moment spills open, and we are here to receive it and bear witness. You know, what's so nice about writing is that you can really say what you want to say in a very concise way, and I've been rambling, but that's it, isn't it? I mean, that we are here to bear witness, and we are here to receive it, receive the moment. And what matters more than anything right now is that we are open to that, you know, and attentive to that, I think. God, what else can we do?
I've heard the phrase bearing witness a billion times, but somehow when I hear you say it, I can't help playing with it homophonically or whatever. Bearing the witness must be born, carried, and bearing, B-A-R-I-N-G, the witness must be uncovered, naked.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it's bearing witness, yeah, indeed, because it's. I think it's a responsibility to what it is that we are seeing and to our own being, to be present, fully present in the world. And it's also, get down to it, it's the very least we can do. Hmm. You know, if we're unable to be in the streets or, you know, unable to be physically involved in a response to what's happening, for whatever reason, at the very least to be fully aware and thoughtful and in conversation with friends and helping the children are really suffering now with this. Hmm. You know, we're seeing that. And the young people, now everyone is responding profoundly to this. Our lives are so deeply affected. And so, yeah, I think that's part of the thoughtfulness I was talking about, you know, to engage with it thoughtfully, also so that we can, yeah, help the children through this and help them live their moments as richly as possible. Mm. And also, yeah, hope that they will be the artists and scientists of the future who will find the ways out or the ways back. Hmm. Forward.
You move so seamlessly between disciplines and between genres, dissolving the so-called borders between them. Has this always been your practice, to move in and out and through the different expressive forms and vehicles?
I've always been restless, and I think I was very fortunate. I mean, really so fortunate to have a very supportive father, especially very inventive, kind of restlessly minded father, but also, my God, to grow up on a college campus within a, it was very tribal. I mean, it was, the campus at the time was very small and very small student body and surrounded by woods, but with this wealth of culture. And so in terms of the creative imagination, the world just seemed boundless to me because there was a library, there was also the biology lab with its mysteries. There was also the theater where there would be performances of all kinds, but also cinema. So I was, at the age of 8, around the time I found that library, I also saw the movies of Jean Cocteau, for God's sakes. What a gift. I mean, many of them look pretty dreadful now, but at the time, you know, they were mind-blowingly wonderful. The only one that holds really is Beauty and the Beast. Mm-hmm. And then maybe, too, student of my father's gave me this magnificent library, uncut library of books from the 19th century, bound in red leather that was articulating when, by the time I had it. And that was a big collection. It came in a big box. Every known fairy tale at the time, from Ireland, from Japan, from China, from Russia, from Portugal, from West Africa. I mean, whatever was known was contained in one of these volumes. And I think I've never quite gotten over from the wondrousness of that experience and the restless reading that it demanded. And I think growing up in the natural world and growing up in forests, which is what the faculty brats kind of did because the forests were there, and being surrounded by creatures. The great tragedy, too, is the vanished insects, the vanished butterflies, the enormous flocks of birds that we would see as children. And all that speaks so deeply to the child, and all that expresses, yeah, the incredible restlessness and variety of the world. So for me, the creative experience is simply another form that takes. And though I didn't expect to be a writer, I did always write as a child, and I've never stopped painting. And it just seems to me that the creative imagination chooses a vessel. And so I'll be have this impulse, and it's either going down to the studio and painting, or it's this is a poem, this has to be a poem, whatever this is, whatever this energy is wanting, you know, that's the vessel, or this is a novel. And I was very, very surprised when I became a novelist. I didn't expect that to happen. Just pounced. And that, I think that of all of the things that I do, the novel has had the biggest, has proposed the most energy and placed the biggest demands on me.
What are those demands?
Wanting, you know, needing 3.5 years, perhaps, or needing 18 months of absolute passionate, ongoing, daily engagement. Whereas the other things have been very important, but have never demanded that much time. Or, well, certainly maybe intensity has shown up, but a sustained intensity, you know, that an intensity that, yeah, has to sustain the work for perhaps years on end. But it just feels to me that, yeah, there are these many possible vehicles, you know. And my guess is it's not just me. I mean, I think this is the way the creative imagination works. The only difference, perhaps, is that I was very fortunate to have this deeply imaginative and attentive father, and to be in a place that one could restlessly explore. I mean, the campus belonged to the children over field period and over the summers. So we had not just the forest to ourselves, but we had the library, and we had, probably unknown to the authorities, the biology lab to examine. And then all throughout the year, these amazing cultural experiences just ongoing. And I was amazed when I realized, and the other thing which is immensely important is that the campus was completely interracial and sexual, and that I grew up in a world where I saw men holding hands together, women holding hands, I saw women embracing, I saw mixed couples holding hands and embracing. I saw, this was just my life. It was all around me. I was living in a place where you could, the sense was you could talk about anything, but to, you know, somehow do it maybe thoughtfully, you know. And then I began to discover that the world around me was very different, you know, that there were lynchings going on, that it was extremely dangerous to be gay in my high school, that I was myself something of an outlier because my father was a college professor and it was, McCarthyism was rising up, and, or my father was Cuban, that suddenly that meant something in school. You know, and it was bewildering and shocking, you know, or to visit a grandmother in Florida and see the one black person coming on the bus go to the back of the bus and actually see what I'd heard about, and to go back to join her, my grandmother's concern, and the woman saying, I really appreciate this, darling, but you get back to that front of the bus and we'll both get into trouble. You know, so the realities kept sort of opening their dark portals for me. But I've never forgotten that experience. I probably should write about it at some point, you know, growing up in this fully integrated, environment with, among children who for the most part have been given liberty to explore the world, both physically and intellectually, and a world also that was much safer than it is now, so that we could spend years alone even in the woods without danger, except from poisonous snakes, and we knew how to walk in the woods with a stick and walk safely in those woods. We knew, you know, we knew what to look for. It is amazing to me now how all of us thrived in those woods without risk. And then memories of being in a meadow absolutely flush with butterflies, just tens of thousands of butterflies, or lying on our backs in Barrytown, looking up at the sky and watching the birds pass. And it's like the trains. They would just go on and on and on and on. I remember looking at the train tracks in Barrytown and counting the cars and lying with my little friends on our backs, looking up at the sky, trying to count the birds, and it was impossible. This past week, there were geese on the lawn across from me. I live right across from the state park, and I was very excited to see the geese, and there were 12 of them.
Wow. Well, thank you so much, Rikki, for speaking with me today. As always, I love our conversations.
Well, this is so much fun. Let's do some more of it.
Yes.
I was feeling I went on and on and on, and you have 100,000 minutes to cut.
Oh, no, not at all. I'm just going to cut out everything I say.
Oh, no.
Well, thanks so much for your always keen insight and for commiserating with me on the current state of things within this dumpster fire of a country we live in.
I don't get this gnostical fear of the body. It's just destroying us. It's just horrendous. And what is the connection? God, there's so much to talk about. What is the connection between, that fear of the body and fear of truth and this embrace of the false? And what's going to happen now with these goddamn virtual reality phony videos that are coming our way?
Mm-hmm. Well, I would say the fear of the body and the fear of truth is really fear of mortality.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Fearing the... Yeah. Inevitable, right? We are going to die. Therefore, I must cover up all the body because it reveals that truth. That the deepest truth is that we're facing death. And unfortunately, what we also have is, I was thinking about over the past 3 years, but really over the past 15, 20 years, that we're led by sociopaths who actually are, who are actually suicidal.
I totally agree. They're nihilists. They're suicidal, and they want to take us with them.
Right. And the question is, and you definitely answered that so eloquently. I mean, what are we to do? And that last piece that you read in The Deep Zoo addresses this too. It's not just the writer and the reader, but we are, as humanity, writing and reading each other. So what is that book that we're going to write? Or what is the book that we're reading? And really what we're doing is we're allowing the book to be burned.
Yeah, that's right. We're burning the book.
We're burning the book. We're burning that book.
Yeah.
Frightening.
Oh, yeah. Well, here's something. Upbeat, perhaps. So I just read that the world of the bees, the interactions within the hive of the bees, the whole thing, mirrors the interactions of the neurons in our brain.
Hmm.
So that's enormous, because that implies that the real possibility, which physicists now are looking into, which the mystics have always looked into, that all is mind. Hmm. And if that's so, then perhaps consciousness is quantum, and we're not alone. The consciousness, it pervades the universe, or the universe is leaning into it, which I think is something Carl Sagan thought. But isn't that fabulous that the bees' world and the world within our brain, they mirror each other?
And once again, you're bringing attention to the so-called small as a way of illuminating large.
Yeah, I've never noticed that.
No, that's amazing. That's great. I love it.
I think it's because I was so nearsighted as a child. I was looking at things very closely,
Thanks so much for being on Jamming Their Transmission.
Thank you. Okay.
Oh, thank you.
Bye.
All right, bye-bye. That does it for our show. Thanks for listening to Jamming Their Transmission. I'm John Madera. Until next time, and always, be the strange you wish to see in the world.